Joining us now here in the Knesset in Jerusalem is Malcolm Online, Vice Chairman of the Conference of Presidents. Shalom.
Shalom. Good to see you again.
So here we are, soon a special ceremony for the inauguration of our new president, President Herzog, and you're here especially for that. What are your feelings about this day? You're familiar with Herzog.
I've known him for many, many years in all his incarnations, as most recently as chairman of the Jewish Agency, but long before that, and I knew his father very well when he was ambassador at the UN. And we worked together on the Zionism racism resolution. So there's a long history, and his grandfather, Chief Rabbi, so he comes from great lineage, and I think he continues that tradition of service to both to Medinat Yisrael, but also to Am Yisrael.
So how do you look at the role of the president of Israel? Because as we know, the prime minister is the one who, you know, he's really in charge, and the president is sometimes only ceremonial. Do you feel that it's important, especially from what you met throughout the years?
So I had the privilege of working with many presidents of Israel, and I think each one brings their own unique stamp and emphasis and mode of operation. But the fundamental role as a unifier, as somebody who goes above the political fray, can serve as a focal point, as a symbol for the state and for the people, and to reach out to Jewish communities around the world. I don't think it's competitive with the prime minister. I think it's a very delineated role, but can be very important and very powerful if it's used in the right way.
Exactly. You might even be saying that the prime minister is the prime minister of the state of Israel. The president has the potential of being the president of, I wouldn't say the people of Israel, at least of the Jewish state representative of the people of Jewish people around the world.
Well, I think the prime minister increasingly is the prime minister of the Jewish people, and he's certainly identified as such by most of the media. But the president, because it's not a political or partisan position, has a broader appeal, a broader outreach, I think, in many cases. And when they use the Beit HaNasi as really a house for the people of all people to come, and that means non-Jews as well, that the president can be somebody free of political constraints who can reach out in an unfettered way. And I think President Rivlin did that often. I think Mr. Herzog will do it as well.
And as the state of the Jewish people, do you feel and even demand that the state of Israel be more involved in fighting against anti-Semitism, the big challenge of Jewish people around the world?
I absolutely believe that Israel has a critical role. I think they recognize it. We have the Global Forum on Anti-Semitism coming up, where Jews from around the world and non-Jews will come together under the auspices of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. This is being has been done on a regular basis. COVID obviously interrupted it. But there is a cooperative effort. I think there is a recognition by the governments of Israel and all the political parties that anti-Semitism, a growing recognition, I should say, anti-Semitism is a priority issue for everyone. This affects Jewish security, but also the security of Israel. If our communities abroad are endangered, it obviously harnesses the support in a different way. It may increase identity, some people say, you know, that when we're under assault, a lot of people, and I've seen it personally, who distance themselves from the community are coming back because they realize that this is a war against them. It's not a war against Israel. It's not a war against certain parts of the Jewish community. This is a war against the Jewish faith, the Jewish people, the Jewish state, the Jewish past, and the Jewish future. And they feel it. Half of Americans, Jews, say that they have experienced or know of an anti-Semitic incident. That number is growing all the time.
Even though we're not in those peaks, you know, regarding the battles against Hamas and things like that?
So that obviously is incentivizes some people to engage in more and broader attacks and
but
intensifies them,
as we saw.
No, but after the war, it always, and the pro-Palestinian activists, often with state sponsors, Iran, Turkey, Iran, the Palestinian Authority are behind some of this. But the overall attack goes beyond that, and we see the number of physical assaults. Police Department in New York just came out with a study that thinks 69% of hate crimes are against Jews. FBI last week said that Jews are the primary target for hate crimes in America, and the statistics are overwhelming, and the vast majority of incidents aren't even reported. And we are seeing it every day in many ways manifested in circles of influence like academia, entertainment, media, politics, education. And we have to root it out. We have to fight it in a decisive way.
How do you fight it? I know you maybe put another guard in the synagogue, things like that, but how do you fight it?
Well, physical security is an important part, and there's a greater recognition. As you may know, I started many years ago together with JFNA, the SCAN, Secure Community Network, and many people were skeptical about the need for physical security. Nobody today. And the federal government gives a great deal of money, the largest part of which goes to Jewish institutions, because they are their primary targets, to improve their physical security, whether it's cameras, guards, etc. But that's one phase. I think that there is a much larger issue, and that can be attacked in many ways. One is that Jew hatred has to be called out. It has to be non-Jews who call it out. We're the victims, not the perpetrators. So for us, to protest anti-Semitism is not the key. It is to get those who are in positions of influence, those who mold young people's views, and that means entertainers, that means sports stars, that means those who are on television, those who reach them, should be enlisted to speak out against it in very strong and powerful ways, and it can't be the compromised. Yes, Jews, but also, no, Jew hatred is unique in the numbers and unique in the way that it is being expressed. It is not to exclude others. We want the Asian Americans that came under attack. We spoke out about it. We don't want to see Muslims or Christians or anybody else. And we have to speak about against all of it.
And how about the Jewish hatred that even seeped into the Democratic Party?
So, and that is another realm. So there is legislation, lawsuits to protect students, communities standing up for the students, going after universities where anti-Jewish and anti-Semitic resolutions and incidents occur, and they are not properly addressed. We have to make sure every Jewish student feels protected, knows where to turn to, and will get the assistance they need. And we filed lawsuits, and they do work, and getting alumni, university donors, others involved. And that's true for other institutions. In the political realm, it's also true. We have to demand a certain standard that would be applied to any group. It doesn't mean they can't criticize Israel. But denying Israel's right to exist and crossing that thin line very quickly from anti-Zionism or anti-Israelism to anti-Semitism, because they want to deny Jews the rights they accord all other people. So the Jewish state becomes the collective Jew. Instead of saying, I hate that Jew, which they may not be allowed to do or be criticized for, you say, I hate the Jewish state, the collective Jew. And I think many people who didn't want to hear this message before are hearing it now and realizing that it's true, that Israel is just a substitute for attacking, but they mean all of us.
And are you in touch with the seniors and the officials at the Democratic Party?
Yes, and many of them are deeply concerned, but I think we should just assure people. The vast majority of the American people stand with Israel. Mm-hmm. Two-thirds still support Israel. Overwhelmingly in Congress, there's still support. There is a growing minority in there that is more vocal, that has been able to enlist more people in, you know, for instance, trying to condition aid to Israel. It was rejected overwhelmingly by the leadership, by the membership. But the very fact that two dozen or so would sign on, or 70 on to another resolution expressing concerns about Israel. Again, you can criticize a particular policy of Israel. That's not anti-Semitism, or every Israeli would be an anti-Semite, because everybody here is critical of the policies in one way or another. But it's about holding Israel not to a higher standard, but to a double standard, an impossible standard. It is to deny Israel the right to defend its citizens, to criticize it for standing against 4,000 rockets. It is to demonize and delegitimize Israel and the Jewish people. And I think it's critical that we make that distinction. You have to use the term anti-Semite in a very limited way, because it's a powerful accusation. Don't diminish it. Don't just use it. You have to apply it where it really counts. And I think what we have to do is to enlist the people of goodwill, which is the majority of people, and demand of the leaders of the Democratic Party. And we have been meeting regularly with them, and we find them very receptive. Mm. But it means when somebody in Congress makes statements that are abhorrent, attacking the Jewish people or Israel in ways that are not acceptable, they have to pay a price for it. And if it's excused, then everybody reads that as a message. So it's not Republican or Democrat, liberal or conservative issue. We have to see to it that everybody is held to account. You know, I warned many years ago, as you know, about the model of Europe for America, where we saw the loss of the political center and the parties becoming more and more extreme.
Both sides.
All sides. Mm-hmm. And we are seeing that now. The anti-Semitism comes from the extreme left, the extreme right, from Muslims, from minorities, from other sectors. And we have to fight them all. We have to assure that the next generation is going to be secure. And that means what we do today will determine that.
Well, it's a work. Malcolm Online, Vice Chairman of the Conference of Presidents, thank you very much for joining
us. Always a pleasure to be with you.